So most of the things that I'm going to show in this section comes from, let's say, one paper. It's a review about dissolution DNP. It's called Practical Dissolution DNP by many people of the team. So I put this reference here in the front page. You can have a look. So the first thing is, even before performing DNP, we'll see that at very low temperature, at 1 Kelvin or 4 Kelvin, we have a relatively high sensitivity. Yesterday, when I talked about the probe calibration, I gave you numbers like 10 million of SNR per mole. So we have a pretty high sensitivity. At the same time, we have relatively long relaxation times or buildup times. So the DNP buildup times are on the order of minutes. For protons, the relaxation times can be tens of minutes or even hours. So the relaxation times are very long. So because of that, we actually adapt the NMR measurement strategy to these conditions. We don't want to do 90 degree pulses, otherwise we have to wait minutes or hours before we can record the signal again. So what we tend to do is apply very small angle pulses. So we only apply like microwatt pulses that will tilt the magnetization by a fraction of degree. Therefore, the signal is weaker than what we would get with a 90 degree, but the magnetization remains almost unchanged. So we use small angle pulses. We'll come back on that after. So the signal integral is reduced. Instead of being 1 with 90 degree, it's a sinus theta. And this has many virtues. It doesn't affect the magnetization, and it avoids to saturate the receiver. If you do a 90 degree on protons on a hyperpolarized sample, even on a thermal sample, maybe, I don't know, we'll have to check, you will saturate the receiver. There's too much magnetization down there. So we have a signal integral that is proportional to sine theta. And the perturbation on the magnetization goes with cos theta. So in the approximation where theta is close to zero, the magnetization that remains is cos zero is one. So you don't affect the magnetization. If you want a precise measurement of the SNR, it goes with the polarization. It's proportional to the polarization time the sine theta, which is the pulse that you apply. And if you apply many pulses, sometimes we do that, we apply like a series of 16 or 32 or 64 small angle pulses, you have to take into account the depletion of the magnetization. So every time you pulse, you deplete the polarization by cos theta, so you have to sum cos theta to the power I being the number of pulses. And this gives you the signal that you get at the end of the acquisition, and it allows you to really correct for the effect of angle pulses and many pulses. This assumes that during the time you measure, there's no relaxation. We measure on a time scale that is below a second. Pulses are microsecond. Acquisition is 100 microsecond or a millisecond. It's very short. Even if you do 64 pulses, it's less than a second. So during the time you measure your signal, the relaxation is insignificant because relaxation happens on a very much longer time scale. So here's the sequence. We do a series of 90 degree pulse to wipe out the magnetization. That's optional, but that's if you want to start from zero, so you destroy the polarization. Then you may switch on the microwaves or not, depending on if you want to measure a thermal signal or a polarized signal. And you apply trains of small angle pulses. And every time you do that, you get a point that you can integrate. And on this figure, you see the integral versus time for a proton in a DNP juice. And you see it can build up to a positive value. Black is 1 Kelvin, blue is 4 Kelvin. Or if you change the microwave frequency, you can build up a negative polarization. Again, black is at 1 Kelvin and blue is at 4 Kelvin. And you get on this particular sample about 50, 60 or minus 70% polarization on the proton. 100% being the full polarization, all the spins polarize on the same energy level. While the thermal polarization in the same conditions at 4 Kelvin is only 0.16% for proton. Okay, so we start with a polarization that is lower than 1% and we end up with a polarization that's greater than 50%. So here you have a table with some like typical properties of the sample. Our DNP juice at 3.8 Kelvin has a build-up time of 1 to 2 minutes. If you put more radicals, it would be faster. If you put less radicals, it will be slower. We use a D1, which is the time between each pulse, that is typically between half a second to 30 seconds. We use a very small receiver gain, 0.25, I mean as low as we can, so as not to saturate the receiver. And the angles that we use, it's usually between 0.01 degree to 1 degree, but it's more likely 0.1 or 0.01. Okay. So it's very, very different from what people usually do in NMR when they want to get to maximize sensitivity in the liquid state or even in magic angle spinning. So every time we submit a paper, we get a review, and one reviewer say, you made a mistake here. It cannot be 0.01 degree. No, yeah, it is. And same for carbon. It's about the same. The DNP times are longer. The D1s are usually a bit longer. And we can sometimes increase a bit the gain to get more sensitivity. And the angles are a bit higher. It's usually between 1 and 5 degrees. Yes, Kirill.
Sami, how do you calibrate the pulse? Is it a coil with homogeneity? Do you have special tricks?
We use this, we have a trick. I will come back on the trick very soon in the next slides. You can do it with a nutation, yeah. But usually you it's not good. You get 10-15% yeah. Error on the calibration. And that's super important in our case. If you have a 15% error on the yeah. Calibration of the pulse, you have a 15% error on the quantification of your polarization, so we need a very, very precise calibration of the pulse. And so, again, it's something we describe in this paper. Okay, so the polarization that you measure with microwave is a function of the polarization that you measure at thermal equilibrium times the ratio between the signals that you get. So you may get an enhancement of 100, for example, in signal. So it means that your polarization is 100 times bigger than what you measure at thermal equilibrium without microwave. But then we have to correct for the gain, because sometimes we use a different gain, receiver gain. And we have to correct for the number of scans and the angle that we use, because we may use different parameters for the thermal equilibrium and for the polarized signal. In practice, we try to keep the gain, the pulses, the number of pulses, the angle, all the same. So we don't bring in some extra error. We use exactly the same parameters for thermal and for polarized signal. But just to know, you may need to correct for the gain, and you may need to correct for the pulses. Again, for the pulses, you have a ratio that is the sine theta. This is the amount of signal that you measure times the sum of the cos theta to the power I. Here it's I minus 1, because it goes from 1 to n. And this gives you a correction for the angle that you apply on the thermal and polarized signal. If you use the same theta, but different number of pulses, this simplifies greatly here. For example, you may use 16 pulses for the thermal signal and only one for the polarized, because you have so much sensitivity. And this shows you, for a certain number of scans, if you do 5-degree pulses, you do many 5-degree pulses and you acquire, you will get more and more signal. But at the same time, you get more and more noise with a square root of n. Plus, at the same time, you deplete the magnetization. So after a certain time, it's not worth doing more pulses. You will start to decrease your SNR. So this shows, as a function of the number of scans, the SNR that you get. And for example, for 5-degree pulse, if you would like to get the optimum SNR, you may want to apply something like 300 pulses. In practice, we never do that. We do 1, 16, 32, and we're happy with it. But the applying 300 pulse means that you deplete the magnetization significantly by, I don't know, 60%. So this is really something you have to think about. What am I measuring? Do I want to deplete the magnetization or not? Do I really want to maximize the sensitivity? It's quite a complicated thing. But the general rule is that when it's polarized, it's like one pulse, small angle. And for thermal equilibrium, the sensitivity is much less, so we apply the same pulse, but we do many pulses. So we have to take into account only this factor, the number of scans. We have to take into account the depletion. The problem is, how much do you deplete? You don't really know until you know the exact angle that you apply. If you apply a 5-degree or a 4.5-degree, that's a 10% difference. So you may think, well, it's minor difference, 0.05 degree, but it's huge difference. So what we do is something we call the small angle decay experiment. We apply a series of small angle pulses, and we acquire, and we repeat on and on and on until the magnetization is fully depleted. So you see here, for example, we apply what we think are 5-degree pulses. We apply 64, and we measure. Then 64, and we measure, 64, and we measure, 64, etc., etc. And the signal goes down. And this curve has a very, very simple formula that simply depends on the pulse angle and the number of pulses that you apply. So when you fit this curve, you just get the one free parameters, which is the angle. And here we thought we had set the pulse angle to 5 degrees, but in reality it was 4.25 degrees. And so we have an error bar also on this angle of 0.01 degree. And so this will induce some error in the quantification of the polarization, but it's pretty good. So okay, so the small angle tune, what decay, it's you get more SNR because you do many pulses, but at the same time you deplete the magnetization. But the nice thing is that you get a really accurate quantification of the pulse angle. So in practice, what we will do is we will polarize with small angles. And for the thermal equilibrium, since after we want to quantify the polarization, we'll measure with many angles, many pulses. So we polarize. And then for the thermal equilibrium, we don't polarize. We wait for relaxation, and we do many, many, many angles. We do many, many pulses. We do this experiment. And out of this experiment, what we get is a very, very good signal on the thermal equilibrium, good SNR, and quantification of the angle. And so with these two experiments, we can really quantify the polarization that we had. So in order to fit that, you can make a very simple fit with stop spin. You get a T2, which is not a real T2. And out of this T2, we have a little spreadsheet in which you can calculate the exact angle.
I will show all this.
Yeah, there will be a lot of repetition with Quentin. But that's good, because I explain and then he will show and explain again if needed. But again, interrupt if you have questions. Yes, Anna?
So this is done in the solid state, so on the center of the polarizer?
Yes, absolutely.
And do you also do this after dissolution in your observation magnet?
Yes, we have a similar procedure in the liquid state that Chloé will describe. It's a bit similar.
The T1 will be much.
Yeah, the T1 will be much shorter, yeah.
So can you do the same term?
Do you mean the small angle?
Yeah.
No, we don't do that.
Okay.
No, because the acquisition time in the liquid state is long. It's on the order of the T1, right? Smaller than T1, but it's on the order of the T1. Whereas in the solid state, the acquisition time is hundreds of microseconds because the lines are so broad, whereas the T1 is hundreds of minutes. So.
Some people, some way, I don't know how, they did more or less the same in MRI conditions. I've seen in the paper that they inject the hyperbolic sample in an MRI and quantify the angle the same way that you did. But I don't understand
okay.
Because there's this T1, T2 problem.
Yeah. So this is very simple. Small angles, you measure how the signal grows with and without microwave, and you get the enhancement. Of course, you have to be very careful about applying the right correction factors, and you can make many mistakes there. Even if you don't make any mistake in the way you measure and quantify your polarization, you can have artifacts. So there's many reasons why you'll get a wrong polarization. One is saturation of the receiver. You may end up in a situation where you have so much signal that you are not in the linear region of your receiver. This has to be calibrated by the company, Bruker, and you should activate the saturation detection so that, on spectrometers you can either activate or not the saturation, so that the spectrometer warns you if you are in the non-linear regime of the receiver. You can have a line shape that depends on the polarization. So you may have a very nice line shape at thermal equilibrium. You polarize, it goes to 1, 2, 3, 5, 10% polarization, everything's fine. And when you get beyond 40%, so you break the high temperature approximation, you start to have nonlinear effect. You have a very high ordering of the spins. So for example, one spin is always used to see as many spin up as spin down. So the couplings are like random, and suddenly his environment is full of spin down. So the line shapes start to shift. You have some example here. I'll show after. And then you can have radiation dumping. This is known in cryoprobes in the liquid state. You can have a very, very strong coupling between the spins and the coil that creates some artifact. Usually you don't have that in the solid state because the lines are so broad. The magnetization is not so high, but with DNP at low temperature, you end up with super, super strong radiation damping. So I tried long to hide that under the carpet and not to work on it, because it's very complicated. Some people, I think in Paris, are working on this. It can be a real nightmare. What radiation damping does is that when you have a positive polarization in red, it tends to broaden the line. It tends to bring back the magnetization faster to the z-axis. Okay, it's like the spins themselves induce a kind of pulse that acts on themselves and bring them back to the z-axis. But then when you do a negative DNP, you have the opposite effect. So you polarize negative, and the spins couple with the coil and act on themselves to prevent themselves to go back to the plus z-axis. So it's like the auto spin lock. And so you end up with line widths that are much narrower. Line narrowing due to radiation damping. And here you have 50 kilohertz on positive and 15 on negative. Maybe we can do this experiment with Quentin. I don't know if it's there's time for it. You will see it's very significant. And this is not a massive effect. When I'm talking about massive effect, you get a positive DNP that is 100 kilohertz or more, and the negative can narrow down to a single point. Okay, so you get like hundreds of hertz, or basically your FID never decays, it just keeps going. And this is a big problem because as soon as your NMR line changes in shape, you're not quantitative anymore. You cannot measure polarization precisely. This is counterintuitive. In principle, the integral of the line is proportional to the polarization, to the magnetization. But that's only true if you have no dead time. That's only true if you can measure the first point of your FID. In reality, the integral of the Fourier transform is proportional to the first point intensity of your FID. But you can never measure this first point of the FID because the spectrometer has a dead time. The dead time is 4.5 microseconds on the Bruker spectrometers. Might seem short, but your line, your NMR line is maybe 50 kilohertz broad, so it decays in 4 microseconds. It decays significantly. So between the time you pulse and the time you acquire, your signal has already decayed by, say, a factor 2 or so. So there's part of the signal that is invisible because it's in the dead time. If the line doesn't change in shape, it's always the same proportion, so it's quantitative. But if the line shape changes, the amount that you lose during the dead time changes, and therefore you cannot measure polarization anymore. Then you can maybe do an echo, but the echo will destroy your polarization, and it's not very nice when you have to wait hours before it recovers, or minutes. So, Nathalie? A black car? And no. Non, merci à toi. Yes.
So these effects, you're saying that they're mostly would be at high polarization.
Yeah.
How high, should we expect when we start expecting this?
The radiation, the line shape,
yeah,
dependent on polarization. I mean, when you have a few percent of polarization, you start to see a few percent of change. For example, if you have coupled spin, like on the right, this is just water. So you have, is it water? You have water, so you have two protons that are coupled, so you have a kind of peak pattern with two peaks. Usually they have the same intensity. But if you have high polarization, the intensity starts to change. In the extreme case of 100% polarization, you would have only one peak, and the other peak would disappear. So say, for example, here in the middle, you have a 21%, an arrow that points to one spectrum, 21%, it's already massive. So yeah, I would say a few percent, and you start to see the effect, if you have sufficient SNR. And this happens in every coupled system. We did that on, for example, Formate, or we're about to publish a paper on line shape analysis on Formate. And we published another one with Stuart.
This is this one.
But this is water. Oh yeah, we published this. And this here is the radiation dumping, you see, for a DNP juice, typical DNP juice. But then if you have more protons in your sample, if you have more protons, you have more magnetization, and the radiation dumping become even bigger and bigger. And you can start to see that, again, with a few percent of polarization. So we will have a look with Quentin. When you do the build-up, we'll see the first points. They have the same line shape. And after a few points, after a few tens of second, you start to see the line shape that broadens or narrow. And this is very typical for protons. For carbon, the magnetization is lower because the gamma is lower. Usually we don't have any trouble with radiation dumping for carbon. So we can quantify carbon polarization quite well. And for protons, it's very often a hurdle. I think I missed a question from Anna. No, it was you. Yeah, you could. Hola? Yeah, so when you don't do DNP, your polarization is always positive for a spin 1/2. It means that the spins are in excess in the lowest energy level. Okay, it means in a classical view that the arrow is along the magnetic field. The spins are pointing in the direction of the magnetic field. It's always like that for a spin 1/2. But when we do DNP, we can decide to polarize the spins anti-parallel to the magnetic field, or to bring the spins on the highest energy level. I don't know if you remember when we looked at the solid effect or the thermal mixing or cross effect, we had a positive lob, a positive polarization, and then when we keep increasing the microwave frequency, we will hit an optimum where the spins are polarized negative. Yes.
Why is one better than the other? There's always like one that's slightly better than the other.
You mean positive and negative?
Yeah.
It can be because of the EPR line shape. It's often because of radiation dumping. So it's often a mistake. We've been doing this mistake in many, many papers where we published too low positive polarization because we underestimate the polarization because the line gets broad. And we publish too high negative polarization because we overestimate the polarization because the line gets narrower, so we get more signal just because of the narrowing. So we kept publishing negative polarization values of 80, 90, 95. And one day we got a HIPSO material, a silica matrix, HIPSO 5, that polarized super well. We got more than 100% polarization on proton. And we realized, yeah, now we have to worry about radiation dumping.
Now we got 105% if you want, because I was going to do positive polarization, but for fun we could do it negative, and then you would have zero, like,
Yeah. Now we are after.
In the session.
Okay, in the next session, okay. Yeah, that's would be nice. Yes?
How are you sure that, like, you published, you professionals published, and wrong numbers, so how not to make this mistake? Do you have a recipe how to be a bit more correct?
So we're trying to do that. You can, if you know the line weights, you can extrapolate how much polarization you lose during the dead time, so you can do an estimation with a very simple correction, but that's assuming a certain shape of your line, like a Lorentzian, but it's never Lorentzian, so the lines are a very strange shape. So it's really hard to know exactly how much you lose during the dead time. For that, you would have to make more complex simulations. And I don't think you're going to talk about that, Quentin, but that's also something Quentin is working on. Do a full quantum mechanical simulation of the line shape with DNP and with radiation dumping. But yeah, to answer the question, no. I mean, we don't really have a good way to precisely quantify that right now. So we just do a correction, know that there is an error on the correction and increase the error bar. So you see, for example, the Ipso paper, we have 95% plus or minus 10%. I mean, yeah. Yes?
So, if, for example, because I was thinking previously, if we have the same line width for both positive and negative, that that would be an indication that there was no or minimal radiation damping, but now you're saying that it could also be due to the DNP line shape, so we can never be sure.
You cannot be sure. I mean, if the line shape doesn't change, then you can be pretty sure that what you see is real.
But it changes a little bit with polarization to make it easy. It changes a little bit with polarization, so that's really hard.
Yeah. One way to suppress radiation damping is to put less sample, because if you put only 1 microliter instead of 100 microliter, you decrease the magnetization by 100, and you most likely suppress most of the radiation damping. That's one way. But then it becomes hard to quantify your polarization because the thermal signal becomes very weak. Another way is to kill the quality factor of the probe. Yeah. So just build the worst probe you can, and the quality factor will be lower, and the radiation damping will fade.
This is equally difficult for the thermal signal.
Yes. Yeah. So we're never really sure about our proton polarization, but then we do CP, and that's a good way to get a sense of how much proton polarization you get. So we apply microwave, and we observe a buildup. So polarization as a function of time. And one trick that we use is microwave frequency modulation. We irradiate the EPR line with microwaves that span a certain breadth, a certain width. And Quentin showed that yesterday in the microwave parameters. You can, for example, here see a sinusoidal frequency modulation. That's what we did at the beginning because we had a device that could do the job. Now we do triangular, we notice it's slightly better. So we use triangular shape, and what we observe is that the DNP buildup is usually faster and higher if you set the parameters properly. So here's an example of 25 millimolar temple in a DNP juice at 6.7 Tesla. The buildup in circles is without modulation with 25 millimolar. It's suboptimal, but when we apply the modulation, you get the black points, and we get a faster and a higher polarization. Now, if your concentration of radicals is really optimal, the modulation doesn't help that much. That's really for like suboptimal radical concentration. So what you have to optimize is the frequency, the modulation breadth, delta, the modulation rate, F mod, so do you modulate at 1 kilohertz or 500 hertz or more, and the microwave power. So it's a few parameters to optimize to get optimal DNP with frequency modulation, but it's usually worth it because it's very robust then to many sample formulation. If you put not enough radicals, it will usually compensate. Okay, so frequency. By setting the frequency, you get either on the positive lobe or the negative lobe. By setting the breadth, you see that there is an optimum around like 60, 80 megahertz. And then it goes down. The frequency of the modulation, there's also an optimum at around 1 kilohertz. And then if you go too fast, it goes down again. Basically, you have to modulate faster than the electron T1. That's the kind of rule of thumb. And this is optimization of power. We see that with modulation, we need less power than without modulation for efficient saturation. And this is something we're we're confirming these days with the last measurement we did on Tuesday night. It shows that modulation helps saturation. So there are many factors on which DNP depends. To get back to the DNP formula for thermal mixing, you already identified many factors. So the ESR line shape, Fi, the thermal equilibrium polarization, which depends on the temperature and the field, the leakage factor, Fl, which depends on the concentration of nuclear spins and T1s of these nuclear spins. We saw that if you have a lot of protons, this hampers the DNP because it creates a lot of magnetization that decays. The gamma, again, protons have a higher leakage than carbon. These are the polarization factors. And then here on below, you see depends on the saturation of the electron, which depends on the T1 of the electron, the microwave field strength, the ESR amplitude, and the irradiation frequency omega m. So the first factor is DNP depends on is magnetic field in the thermal mixing regime, in our regime. And it's been mainly performed for decades at 2.5 to 3.5 Tesla from the 70s to 2010 or so. It's been done in this range. In 2004, there was an attempt by the group of... I don't know who's the head of the group. It's Goetz, the first author. It's a team in Germany who's doing particle target experiments, like high energy physics, and they try to go to 5 Tesla. Because the theory of thermal mixing says, if you look at the equation, that increasing the field should increase the polarization, almost proportionally. And what they observe is that the DNP would collapse with several radicals, tempo, porphyric oxide, EDBA, so some of the radicals that they use, for all of them it would collapse. This was in 2004. And we didn't really understand why. So at the time I was doing my PhD, we decided to also try it. So we started at 3.35. And then we went to 5 Tesla. And yeah, we got much better polarization in the same conditions with the same radicals. So there must have been a problem here with a microwave source or with the construction of the waveguide or I don't know what. But the technology was there. You could buy the microwave sources, but for how many, like four years, nobody tried because, I think because of this paper. And so we are super happy to see that DNP works pretty well. Again, we got 80% proton with probably some radiation dumping. I would have to go back to the data, so it might be only 60 or 70. And then later on, in 2012, we went to 6.7 Tesla because the technology became available from VDI. They started to sell doublers that could double 94 gigahertz to 180. And there we got typically 90% proton polarization. It was in good agreement with the thermal mixing equation. So today, the state of the art is usually around 7 Tesla. It seems like the sweet spot. But we could also work pretty well at 5. On sample temperature. Now this has an impact on the polarization that you get, but also on the rate. You see, for example, here a figure that shows a 50 millimolar temple DNP juice at 7 Tesla. The polarization depends on temperature. So if you go down to 1 Kelvin, it's in this case about 80%. And if you warm up to 4 Kelvin, it goes down below 40%. And at the same time, the DNP rate in red goes from 0.01 second minus 1, that's 100 second, to about 0.025, so that's 4 times faster. I don't know how So that's about 20, 30 seconds or so. Okay, so going higher in temperature, you get less polarization, but it builds up faster. And that's true at different fields. So it was true at 3.35 Tesla, it's true at 6.7 Tesla, and it's true at 7 Tesla. One thing that you have to also take into account is at 3.35 Tesla, the build-up time at 1.70 second, 7 Tesla, have slower DNP when you go to higher field. Lower temperature or higher field will lead to slower build-up times. But it's still quite acceptable to have a few minute build-up at 1 Kelvin. Yeah, question?
Just a comment. You said you write here unpublished, but this is in our paper on spin diffusion.
Okay.
It's published, and this is probably where the case where I put the most effort in quantifying the polarization, because I used one of these resistance in the, so I put a resistance in the NMR circuit to kill the Q factor, mm-hmm. to use radiation damping, and this value is probably the most trustworthy measured. Yeah. Maybe still slightly underestimated, because we still see the line broadening a little bit.
Ah, yeah.
But this almost 80% proton polarization is probably the real value.
But it's positive, so you underestimate. So it might be more, but it's...
Maybe
more
than 80.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Then, polarizing agent. Type and concentration. If you change your radicals to, instead of tempol, you may use totapol or amupol. We tried that at many radical concentration. It changes a bit the line shape of the DNP spectrum and the speed at which you polarize. So you might find better radicals. We never really embarked in this kind of disease, but here, during there was a PhD of Basil Vuichoux, we tried a few biradicals, and we were really depressed because we tried many radicals, and the best was always tempol. So we decided to stick to tempol, but doesn't mean that there are no other radicals that could work better at 1 Kelvin. I mean, there have been a lot of development in MAS DNP. They found some really nice radicals, but it seems like it doesn't translate to 1 Kelvin. We should maybe find another direction to improve the DNP performances at 1 Kelvin. Then, last factor, or maybe not last, is the type and concentration of nuclear spins that are present in your sample. So you may have protons, deuterons, that's what we have the most in our DNP juice, proton and deuterons. If you look at the carbon polarization at 5 Tesla and 50 millimolar tempo, you see that the more deuterons you have, the less protons you have. So when you deuterate the sample, you get more polarization. We have the same observation at 3.35 Tesla. We look at carbon and proton polarization as a function of the deuteration, and the more deuteration we get, the more polarization we get. This is because if you look at the equation, there's this leakage factor that is significant for protons because it goes with the polarization times the gamma, so it goes with the square of the gamma. For protons, it's big, this leakage factor, and if you have too many protons, it creates a big leakage that hampers your polarization. Also, the buildup becomes slower. So we can put more water?
No, less water.
Yeah. So in the DNP juice that you prepared, you had only 10% water. Yeah, you can put nothing. If you have, if you want to polarize a molecule that contains enough protons for CP, you don't even need to put 10% of water.
The DNP might be a little...
Maybe...
Because you need spin diffusion?
Yeah.
Maybe it's a little slower?
We never...
So you say that it's a
Yeah,
but then you also want spin diffusion to help you?
Yeah.
If you don't have water... I don't
know... Yeah. I mean, with the... with the molecules that we use for testing that, we had a few molar of acetate, for example. So that, like, if you have 3 molar acetate, so already 10 molar of protons, we don't see any effect. But if you have a, yeah, if you have a few millimolar of a molecule you want to polarize, you may want to add some protons in the DNP juice, or if you have a deuterated molecule. But I would say, as long as you have a few molar of protons, the spin diffusion will, in principle, be fast enough. So in an extreme case, you may really need to add water. It's more like a habit. We just put 10%. It doesn't change much the polarization, the buildup, and it's there, and it helps. Yeah, question?
Yeah, did I understand you right? You said
a
something about acetate. So if you have acetate, you don't need to have water. Mm-hmm. There is, because the acetate has protons itself.
Yeah.
So as long as the molecule has protons itself, you don't need to have water.
Yeah.
Correct.
I think it's correct.
Okay. Just
kidding. Yeah. We used to do our mixture without water in the past, and then we took the habit of putting 10% water, and we never changed it.
We also like to keep at least a few parameters constant. So to have sanity checks is so much easier.
Yeah. Well, the last, or maybe not the last, but no. The microwave frequency, so depending on the microwave frequency, you may end up with different DNP enhancement, as we saw in the first session, positive or negative polarization. You will have different DNP rate, so this is the rate, this is the buildup time as a function of frequency. And all this can be explained by the EPR line shape. So this is the simulated EPR line shape of temple at 6.7 tesla or 5 tesla. And you can simulate the DNP spectrum, we'll come back on that. And you can see that if you plot the rate of DNP, so 1 over the buildup time, what you observe is something that looks very much like the EPR line. And that's mainly because in the equation, there's the saturation that enters in the equation, and which is a function of the EPR intensity. Okay, microwave power, you see here at 3.35 tesla, you increase the microwave power, you reach a plateau, and then it goes down beyond 100 milliwatt. At 5 tesla, we didn't observe the end of the plateau. We see the beginning, but we don't see how it goes down. And at 7 tesla either, we just see the plateau, and we don't have enough power to go on the other side of the curve. I just want to see how many slides I have. I won't be able to finish in 5 minutes. I think I need 10 minutes more. It would be really a shame not to go till the end. So maybe we can shift everything by 15 minutes, so we end up at 11:45. Yeah, we'll still be on time for the lunch. So microwave power altogether, you can, if you have these parameters, you can do the simulation. And if you use the Provotorov equation or the Borghini model with full saturation, you get the black curve instead of the dots that is measured. If you add some leakage, then you get the gray curves. But you see there's something fundamentally wrong here, because it extends beyond the EPR line. That's because you have to take into account saturation. And so if you take the equations that I show and you plug in an electron T1 here of 0.8 second at 5 tesla or 3 tesla, a B1 of 2 kilohertz, and a leakage of 0.5. This, of course, you can always play to find the best parameters. And you get something that is quite looking like the DNP spectrum. It's far from perfect, but you end up with something that is much closer to the reality. You can use the equations also to put microwave power dependency. So when you add microwave power, the B1 increases, so the polarization increases. While you do that, you can measure the temperature of the sample. You can plug the sample temperature in the equation as a function of power and extrapolate that very simply. And there you can start to have a fit in light in the gray dots that resembles what we observe experimentally. So when we take into account the power and the heating, we see that we can easily simulate this plateau and this decrease in polarization.
Yeah, so basically the plateau and the decay comes from the heating.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, that's how we simulate it. There's no oversaturation effect to thermal mixing, but there's the heating effect that is quite substantial. And here I use the bath temperature, which I know is really far from the real sample temperature. So the effect could be even is probably underestimated. DNP depends on many factors. The polarized nuclear spin that you use enters in the equation. And as we said in the theory section, we end up with the same spin temperature for all spins, nuclear spins. This means that the polarization is different for carbon, protons, deuterons, but as I said, and here's one published data from 2008 at 3 Tesla. For example, with lithium-6, lithium-7, proton, and carbon, you end up with the same spin temperature for all the nuclear spins, which is in very, very good agreement with the thermal mixing equation. Now, DNP is mostly done in the community with trityl radicals. It's simpler. You can do direct C13 polarization and get substantial polarization level on carbon. You don't need to do any fancy NMR experiment. You just switch on the microwave. The build-up time are relatively long. Plus, you have to buy this rather expensive radical. So, as I said before, we work with tempo. It's less efficient for carbon polarization. We only get about 30-40%. 30% at 6.7 Tesla. The build-up are somehow a bit shorter, and it's inexpensive. And the great advantage is that you end up with very high proton polarization. Here I write 90 negative polarization. It might well be 80 in 2 to 3 minutes. So when you use cross-polarization, and this is the curve with the stars, you can end up with up to 70% polarization in 5 minutes under the best condition by doing CP from proton to carbon. And that's what we're going to show you after with Quentin, is how we do that. So you polarize protons from the electron, you get 80% polarization or 90% in a few minutes, and then you cross-polarize to carbon. Cross-polarization takes a few milliseconds. How you do that is by pulsing on proton and carbon at the same time, bringing the magnetizations in the transverse plane and locking the magnetization with the same radio frequency field amplitude, or nutation frequency, sorry. I won't enter into the detail of CP. We'll just show you the sequence and perform the experiment. But you can see that instead of the red curve, which is carbon polarization with tempo, you get the blue curve. So you polarize carbon, at the beginning it's very slow, and then you apply a CP, and you transfer the proton polarization to carbon, and you end up immediately with 40%. And if you do it on and on, you reach, on a routine basis, more than 50%. For some samples it would be 60, but most of the time it's beyond 50.
Voilà.
Just transfer and measure the carbon. If you want, you can decouple proton, but this will destroy the proton polarization. So you won't have your proton polarization back as fast for another CP. And here we want to preserve the proton polarization between the CP to have higher and higher polarization available for the transfer. And at the end, we're not so much interested in the NMR line in the solid state. We just want to get polarization, and then in the liquid state, we will apply decoupling if we want in the liquid state, but not in the solid state. So for the cross-polarization experiment, I go very fast and finish now because Quentin will go through this step in more details, okay? So first we saturate the polarization on both spin, proton-carbon. Then we polarize from some time. And the first thing we do is we check how much proton polarization do we have after that time. Then we check what happens when we do an adiabatic pulse on protons. That is the typical pulse we apply for CP. So here we want to make sure that when we do the CP, we can pulse on proton and spin lock the protons without destroying the polarization of protons. Okay, so even before transferring to carbon, you have to make sure that your pulses have the right effect on protons. So you flip the magnetization in the plane, you lock the magnetization in the plane, and you bring it back on Z, and you see that your polarization is still there, you have not destroyed it. And what we see is that when we have microwaves on and we do this experiment, we lose a substantial amount of proton polarization through relaxation, paramagnetic relaxation. So we invented a trick in 2016 which consisted in switching off the microwaves shortly before applying the pulse. And so when you switch off the microwaves, what you do is that the electron polarization that you have saturated goes back to thermal equilibrium in a few fraction of second. In half a second, the electrons relax back to thermal equilibrium. And what's the thermal equilibrium of electrons at 1 Kelvin and 7 Tesla? It's 99.96%. So all the electrons get polarized, and therefore the paramagnetic relaxation almost totally vanish. The electrons are all in the same state. They cannot do any more any flip-flops, so they cannot change states, and therefore they cannot induce relaxation on the protons. It's like they're frozen. So by switching off the microwave shortly before any pulse sequence at 1 Kelvin, it's as if you have the electron disappear in terms of relaxation. And so when we switch off the microwave, we see that the sequence, as a function of the locking lengths, the spin lock, yields absolutely no loss, or very little losses. Wow, I forgot to switch this off. Very little loss of polarization. So we're ready to do CP. We have the sequence here on protons that we described. We apply the same one on carbon, so we bring both spins on the plane, we lock them at the right frequency with the right power, and we observe a massive transfer of polarization from protons to carbon as a function of the locking time. And after a few milliseconds or 10 milliseconds, we have a full transfer with the microwave switch off. It's better. If you switch on the microwave, you get the red curve with some relaxation. And again, you do multiple CP and you get the blue curve, whereas you get the red curve with the microwaves on during the CP.
Yeah. Sorry, quick question. The theoretical calculation of this effect relaxation, was it like, is it easy to perform a...
I mean, it's hard to have a quantitative fit, because the relaxation is on a very heterogeneous sample with the radicals and many spins that have different distances toward the electrons, so it's really hard to simulate the paramagnetic relaxation. We have some equations in the paper, but what is really important is that whatever the distance, whatever the formulation of the sample, we always observe the same dependence on the electron polarization, which is 1
minus p squared.
So the rate is always proportional to 1 minus p electron squared. And that's the factor that matters. All the other one is a constant for your sample. And what changes is this one. You want to add something?
Yeah, I would say that in fact it is very simple as compared to many other relaxation problems. But it's just one term that oscillates. But it's what is difficult is the spectral density of the electrons. Also, Sami said it's heterogeneous. That's one part, and also how to really.
And if you like turn on the microwave, can you calculate relaxation depending on like microwave power?
Yeah. So the irradiation will affect the electron polarization, which will affect the
because you saturate.
You saturate.
But the microwave themselves, yeah, they do nothing because they act on so few spins that themselves they don't really induce a relaxation.
Right. So the mutation though, but polarization. Okay.
Yeah. Which is like for people doing EPR, this is a bit weird.
Yeah.
I mean, Barnes showed that if you have a lot of power, you can have this kind of decoupling effect. So there might be an effect of the microwave, but in our case, it's probably very, very minor.
Lino really showed this really nicely.
Ah, yeah. This is the last slide. So the last slide is about thermal equilibrium measurement. We will do the DNP, and oh, there's a question. Ready?
Yeah, just a question. Maybe late, but did you try to do a CD with another nuclei?
Yes. We have tried with nitrogen, 15, and this is published, and lithium, and yeah, that's it, only those two other nucleosmin.
And do you think is it possible to use a CP, like a transfer polarization to proton, to two different nuclei at the same time?
It's technically impossible right now, but if you have a three-channel probe, yeah. That's what people do in MAS. They have three. They don't do it in the same time. They go like, they transfer to carbon and then to nitrogen. I don't see why it shouldn't work.
Very difficult. It could be very difficult to make it compatible with DNP, with dissolution, because our geometry is limited by the fact that we have to introduce. If you have a solenoid coil, I guess it's easier.
Yeah, you can have a doubly tuned coil. Yeah. It's more lossy, but it's, I think, what Berdad has done in Paris.
And in solid state, they use it all the time.
Yeah. So we measured the thermal equilibrium at 3.8 Kelvin. Whereas we do the DNP at 1.2 Kelvin or 1.6 Kelvin. And the reason why we do that is because it's very convenient in terms of relaxation. So the T1 at 1 Kelvin can be tens of hours. So we would have to wait days before we can measure the thermal equilibrium signal of carbon. So it would be really impractical. But some people do it. We decided to go to 3.8 Kelvin, a well define temperature at which we know exactly the polarization and at which the relaxation times are smaller. So for carbon it will be around 20 minutes, for protons it will be around a minute, and that way we can measure the thermal equilibrium in a reasonable amount of time. But if you do that, you have to be very careful. You don't want to have your probe changing its properties, so you should keep the same frequency and the same quality factor. In our case, what we observe experimentally is that the quality factor changes a lot when we cool down the probe down to 100 Kelvin or so. But below 100 Kelvin, it's flat. So between 1 and 4 Kelvin, we don't see any difference in quality factor. So we can do it. And so the way we measure is like the DNP. We measure the full buildup at thermal equilibrium. We optionally finish with a mini pulse acquisition, what we call the small angle tune decay, to have more sensitivity at the very end of the buildup. So we have a very good signal on the thermal equilibrium. And usually that gives rise to a very nice proton or carbon signal at thermal equilibrium. And we measure some other signal as well. What we do is we remove the sample and we do the same experiment, so we measure the background of the probe. We have worked hard during the last years to remove the background from the probe with the geometry that we showed. So, for example, here you see there's no background. Then we measure the same, but with the sample cup. So this plastic cup that you see here. And so we tend to use, for quantification, this KELEF. It's a fluorinated polymer that doesn't have protons. And that's really nice. You can measure the background with the sample cup on protons, and usually there's almost nothing to see. I mean, this is fluorinated, but it's not labeled, it's not carbon 12 labeled, so it has some carbon 13. Therefore, we see in gray, light gray, a carbon 13 background. So this is something you really have to be careful of if you want to quantify your polarization. It can be a real issue.